Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our party, and welcome to the first grand rounds of the academic year. As has been our tradition for the last 7 years, we're starting the grand rounds with a State of the Department address and an opportunity. There's no way I can do justice to all the amazing things that everybody in this department has done, but just to pick a few highlights, I thought we would spend the next several minutes together looking at things that have happened over the past year, celebrating our wins and working as we work together during this, what was a very difficult year. When we were planning this way back in May and June, we really felt that we were turning the corner in terms of where we were with the pandemic and life was going to get back to normal. Unfortunately, that wasn't the case. Things actually turned around in a little bit different way than we had expected. And many of you are probably used to seeing these diagrams that I've showed in our various town halls and fireside chats. This is Prem Wardies, who's our resident guru and prognostician, has looked at the way in which the pandemic would play out both here at UHealth and in our area. The red lines represent actual admissions of positive patients to our system, and the green line was the predicted the prediction curve. And as you can see, they pretty much align quite well. And we started way back in March of 2020, and we followed a second wave that we had in last in June of 2020, and then a small spike. I hate to reiterate all of this, but we're currently in our fifth surge, if you will, and probably a surge that was as high as was our highest surge in the past, certainly in terms of numbers of hospitalized patients and ventilated patients. The good news was is that having experienced the roller coaster before, we were well prepared for it this time. And thanks to many of you who worked so hard in taking care of our patients under the leadership of our fine CMO of the hospital, Dr. Tanera Ferreira, the CEO, Dr. Kim Manny, and all the division chiefs from hospital medicine, pulmonary critical care, infectious diseases, all the individuals that were so essential. Every individual was essential during this. The good news is that we seem to be coming down from this wave and hopefully will remain down now that the vaccines are available and that more people are in fact vaccinated. And so from any great disaster, one emerges stronger. And if you notice, this will be the theme of our annual report coming out in the next month or so. And during that, we tell stories. That's what we do. We tell stories, true stories, but stories that detail a narrative of how we survived and how we became stronger because of it. I'd like to illustrate one example of how we became stronger and really showed to the world how important we are and what a difference we made during this pandemic. I illustrate here our very own Hansel Tookes. Hansel won the Sapphire Award from Florida Blue for his efforts in reducing hepatitis C, HIV, in terms of what he did in the community for all of us in the idea exchange, and a well-deserved accolade for Hansel and a credit to our institution. Not to forget Armin Henderson in the upper right in his role that he played in the community during the COVID, whether it was handing out tents, making sure our neighbors in Overtown and our immediate communities were as protected and safe as possible as we did testing and so forth and drive up testing. A second story that needs to be told is that of the initiative taken by Sabrina Taldone, who was essential in developing a home hospitalization program. By use of virtual technology, she was able to prevent patients from being admitted to the emergency room who were not as acutely ill, saving the beds for those that really needed it, and at the same time discharging early individuals from the floors so that they can be followed by pulse ox and all the their blood pressure, and actually image and visualize them with limited, even if they had limited resources, all they needed was an internet connection. And this proved to be very important in our ability to control the number of patients in the hospital. And we're continuing this this program as in different ways in different clinics. And you'll hear more about that in the coming year. And as part of that initiative, something that we never even heard about in 2019, which was virtual medicine, virtual visits, all of a sudden in 2020 became a significant part. That is, 11% of all our visits were virtual. And in 2021, everybody practically jumped on the bandwagon, and 43% of our patient interactions in the ambulatory clinics were, in fact, virtual visits. 1% were on the fly. Overall, today, at the UHealth enterprise level, approximately 17 to 20% of all our interactions are virtual health, with the Department of Medicine leading the way. And there's certain divisions that became much more adapt to, or because of their patients, were able to adapt much better to virtual care. For some reason, sleep medicine was practically 95% virtual. But so, and on the other hand, hepatology was 80% in person, or cellular therapy, or cardiac rehab. So there were some areas that were very prone to having telemedicine become a significant part of it. Palliative care was 96%, nephrology 83%. And if we look at general internal medicine, it was 63% virtual. Now, all of this is changing, and as reimbursements change, we may, and as patients' needs change, we may alter these percentages. But right now, we are welcoming the ability to do telemedicine, and for the most part have supported it in many divisions, some divisions better than others, and we're working on the support that's necessary in order for the providers and the patient to have an equally good experience in this regard. So telehealth has become part and parcel of what we do because of the pandemic. Another story that can be told. And if you talk about opportunities in terms of research during COVID, really, we have led the way in many areas to show how we can adapt and investigate and use our scholarship in order to understand and control the pandemic. If we look on the blue line at the number of grants received during the COVID-19 pandemic in the last, just in the last fiscal year, and then in the orange bars, the types of research, whether it was dealing with samples, patients' blood, doing outreach, looking at a drug profile, there were over 16 protocols like that, or a vaccine trial that there were six. And here you can see the millions of dollars that were brought in terms of the research that was being done at this time. People that didn't have research grants before were able and supported to have research. And I have to thank our vice chair of research, Dr. Abreu, and her committee that she put together very quickly that looked at how we might prioritize all these research protocols so that everyone would be able to participate in the number of patients. And there were times when the patients were plentiful and it was easy, and there were times when there weren't so many patients and we had to triage the patients to the right protocols. If you look at this slide, it shows you the relative contribution of the divisions to that research. By far and away, ID was the major recipient of these types of awards. 65% went to ID, 26% to pulmonary, and 9% to general medicine, for a total of $31.6 million of total costs. Some of the trials made headline news. Our very own Dr. Suzanne Dobleki-Lewis, shown here on the far right, with Dean Ford here, our then Vice President Pence, and still Governor DeSantis in this picture, illustrating the inaugural trial in the state of Florida for the Moderna vaccine that was led by Dr. DeBlecki Lewis. We also had the Janssen trial. We opened up a outpatient clinic on 10th Avenue where we redesigned it to have negative pressure rooms so that we could see COVID positive patients enrolled as part of the protocols and actually patients to be seen because of illness that were COVID positive. We have an ongoing Regeneron clinical trial, which has resulted in the widespread use now of these monoclonal antibodies for pre-exposure or pre-infection, post-exposure COVID-19, and those that have turned COVID positive. And then the Empatica study and the HERO study by Dr. Carrasquillo. So there were multiple trials that we were involved in and really shaped the face of this pandemic, certainly here in Florida and nationally as well. People that were able to utilize, I don't know how they could, with all the time they spent taking care of patients and all the work that they did, but they were able to publish 39 papers from the Department of Medicine alone, just on COVID, 16 in ID, 13 in pulmonary and critical care. And this is just since January, and we're only 8 months into the year. 4 in endocrinology, 6 combined in GI cards, nephrology, and our oncology service line. And they were published in JAMA, the American Thoracic Society, the New England Journal of Medicine. Just to illustrate, one of them I show you, Dr. Ferreira's article in the New England Journal of Medicine, where she was asked to contribute to talk about how she so elegantly and efficiently was able to proceed with 2 hospitals operating at the same time. 1 hospital for COVID positive individuals and another 1 for COVID negative so that elective surgeries could proceed as planned. And this was essential. Many of our neighbors were unable to do that. And even in our current surge that we're in now, Baptist and Jackson for times canceled all elective surgery and procedures while we continued, although maybe at a little bit of a reduced rate, continued to do so. And lastly, there's a story about education. One of our reasons for existence as an academic department of medicine is not just our clinical care and our research, but our ability to train the next generation of practitioners. And so using our undergraduate medical and our graduate medical experiences, we were able to approach medical education in these arenas by supporting a robust public health response to the pandemic. As an example to our students, we had a rapid shift of curricula to virtual when possible by leveraging technology, adjustment of rotations to care for patients, and learners engaging in research and public health initiatives and to continue to care for the underserved, which is so much part and parcel of our mission. We adapted our curriculum to current issues in real time, continuous teaching and learning about the ever-changing medical and social aspects of a pandemic, and model service learning and teamwork to complement the explicit curriculum. And lastly, we protect our limited educational resources and treat learners equitably. So all of these things were important in the Department of Medicine, and whether we were on the admissions committee, whether we trained medical students and taught in the clerkships, and how we interacted with our very essential and vital house officers was all an important part of how we dealt with the pandemic. Now, what about some facts and figures as to where we are now? If we look at the number of faculty that we had in 2019, 2020, and 21, you can see there's been a slow increase in the total number of faculty with about a 1.5% increase. These last 2 years together showed a significant increase. And this is during a pandemic year when Florida hasn't had the best reputation in terms of being able to control a pandemic. We still were able to get many faculty to come and be recruited to the University of Miami. In fact, this year alone, we had 32 new faculty members come to the university. And they're in all different divisions, as you see listed here. Individuals, Dr. Grisette, who is head of our heart failure program in cardiology, Dr. Proxel in digestive health. We had three in general internal medicine. We had a major coup from New York and Cincinnati, where we've gotten people that have come from those institutions to lead our hematology and our multiple myeloma programs. Eight individuals in hospital medicine in order to take care of a census that was once in the 20s, now in the 220s to 240 range. Infectious disease, medical oncology, MTI, and of course our intensivists and pulmonary people. And it's about an equal proportion of recruits, male and female, and a couple underrepresented minorities. We also had promotions this year from assistant to associate professor, Dr. Alvaro Alencar in hematology for his outstanding work as a hematologist and what he's contributed there and how he runs as an associate CMO for Sylvester. Stephanie Brown is our program director for internal medicine and all our internal medicine residency programs, as well as her scholarship in that area and her directorship of the section of MedPeds within the Division of Internal Medicine. Dr. De Lacerda for his leadership and work that he's done not only in the ICU at Jackson, which we all know about, but also for his work in pulmonary hypertension. And Hansel Tukes, who we can't say enough about as to how much he's contributed to the betterment of society and how he's contributed overall to our mission here at the University of Miami. We also have two promotions to full professor in the research track, Dr. Lena Shahadeh from the Division of Cardiology. She works with microRNAs and looked at osteopontin and the effect that it has on stem cells and how it might affect cardiac regeneration during heart failure. And Dr. Verdun, who's an expert in defining new pathways of action in diffuse B-cell lymphomas that he's able to develop new therapeutics for in working with our illustrious lymphoma group. And then we have the promotion from our assistant professors to associate professors to full professors. Dr. Dableki Lewis, I mentioned to you as our guru in vaccines and all she's contributed. Dr. Gershengorn in pulmonary and critical care, who is one of the world's experts in staffing and workforce in ICU and how to organize it. Dr. Oringer, I don't want to embarrass him and call him a father or a grandfather of lipidology, but we'll call him an uncle of lipidology. Dr. Juan Ramos, who is noted for his work on viral induced lymphomas and his promotion, duly recognized a professor. And Joan St. Ange. Now, although some of us may get a little frightened when we get a call from Dr. St. Ange or an email, most of us know what an amazing educator she is, but also a scholar in terms of GME and her contributions that she has made to the department and to overall GME in this nationally in the US. What is our faculty compensation in terms of composition? Compensation, let's not go there right now. Composition, the faculty composition based on rank and gender are illustrated here. The Department of Medicine is on the left and what's happening US in the country is on the right. And you can see that we start out with our assistant professors, 29, and all these numbers on this side add up to 100%. So 29% female, 29% male, and 23% female. Not quite half and half, but certainly better than at the higher levels of professor. And we really need to work on this. This is something that we're paying attention to, although if you notice, we've had equal promotions of male and female to professor in our last group that we just presented, but we have a way to go in that regard. But we are recruiting appropriately and need to continue to recruit female faculty, and we need to understand better why we're not getting more of an equal distribution in the professor level. Now, I must say, this is not unique to the University of Miami. It's occurring nationally. As a matter of fact, we are doing better than national, but that's not good enough. We need to be able to reflect the workforce and the applicants that are out there and doctors in the field of medicine. In terms of our racial and ethnic backgrounds of our faculty, you can look between FY19 and FY20. And then in the third column on the right is the AAMC standard. You can see that for Asian or Pacific Islanders, we're lower than the AAMC standard. We are higher for Black or African American faculty. We do better than the national average. And as one would expect for Hispanic or Latinx, we're 38%, much higher than the national average, but that would be expected, and there's no great accolades involved for that. What we really need to work on are these particular areas here in this area, and we have efforts underway to do that. As a matter of fact, with the leadership of Dean Ford, a task force on racial justice was formed, and there are various subgroups within that task force. And if you notice, many of the leaders of that task force are members of the Department of Medicine. So we hope that Dr. Machaber, Dr. Diaz, Dr. St. Ange, Eisenberg, Dr. Taldone, Dr. Hooks, Dr. Henderson will all be helpful in our efforts to make sure we have more equity and racial justice within the faculty that we hire. Most important was that I think really eye-opening to me, if you haven't read it yet, is an article in this past week's New England Journal of Medicine called Remembering Past Lessons About Structural Racism, Recentering Black Theorists of Health and Society. And it's written by White, Thornton, and Green. It's really, for me, this was an aha moment in terms of reading what they wrote in terms of a study that was done around the University of Pennsylvania area, which was not much different from our geographic area. And they looked at the incidence of tuberculosis in that area in the 1890s. And they clearly showed way back then that there were social determinants of disease that had nothing to do with genetics, that had nothing to do with inevitable results of individual behaviors, predetermined outcomes of biologic difference, of byproducts of immutable social circumstances, and beyond the purview of medicine and public health. They were within our purview. This is structural racism. This is one of the things that's meant by structural racism. And something, I think if you read this, it will totally put in light for those of you that didn't quite get or understand what it means by saying there's structural racism in medicine. This is key. And I, of course, all the other things that we're doing within the department and within the medical school from the dean all the way down is very, very important to reassess all of this. Then we have our clinical mission. And if we look at the number of outpatient visits that we have seen over the years, the numbers have continuing to rise. The red line represents new patient visits, and the blue line represents total visits. Now, I will tell you, approximately 26% of these visits, these RVUs, or actually these are visits, come from our Jackson activities. So Jackson is very much important for the Department of Medicine. It provides us RVUs, and there is a direct importance of our interactions at Jackson, not just for our education mission, and now with our research mission, due to Dr. Kobitz and her team working with Don Steigman to ease the path for research between these two institutions, Jackson is important for us clinically as well. Now, in addition to Jackson, we have, as you know, located throughout the Miami-Dade area, several 13 actually different satellite locations. And these are just part of the tentacles that UHealth and the University of Miami have extended throughout Miami-Dade and Broward County. However, we are embarking on a historic increase in our satellite presence. And here you see illustrated on this slide from West Palm Beach to a couple of other initiatives that I'm going to review with you in a little bit more detail in the next couple of slides. So the first one is West Palm Beach. We have two practices going up there, a concierge practice and a multi-specialty practice. We're recruiting individuals currently, and this will allow us to have a presence in this very up and coming and growing area for ambulatory care. Of course, you'll ask, well, where is the hospital? Where are these people going to be hospitalized? And how are we going to capture other things? Well, we already have Baskin Palmer there, and we're in the process of looking at other partners for inpatient care as well. But for sure, West Palm Beach and many of these people will be able to hook up virtually to our specialists here in Miami. One Medical is an example of a partnership that we've already embarked in that are located throughout the country. Here you can see multiple academic health centers that have partnered with this organization called One Medical, whether it's Mass General, Mount Sinai in the Northeast, UCSF on the West Coast, and everything in between. Here, UHealth is now partnering with this primary care group called One Medical, which will expand our ability to see patients in the primary care setting. We're going to open up 5 clinics, brick and mortar clinics with them that they will bring physicians with them, staff physicians, who will be vetted and approved through the department and the appropriate divisions. And these individuals will have a direct access to all the specialists here at the University of Miami. In the next 5 years, there will be 5 sites going up. In the next year or so, there'll be one on Brickell and one in Aventura. So these sites are coming, and it's another extension of UHealth. In addition, you might have heard about the approval by the board of directors of UHealth for a 150,000 square foot Lennar-like building to go up in Doral. This is a sort of a site map of where it is. And this is to open up in 2024. And then there's another building which is going to open up next year next to it that is already in existence. And this will be for cancer and infusion therapies. And then once the new building is built, this will contain a lot of square feet. Our premier programs will go in there. It hasn't been decided exactly yet who, but the funding has been approved. And then building B will become vacated, probably for primary care and other medical related stuff. There'll be ORs here, procedure rooms. And so Doral is coming on board, and that's definitely here in the future. I mean, not in the very near future. In addition, there's something that you heard about called Solomia. It's now really going to happen. And this is 2026 likely, where the ground will be broken soon. This is up in near Aventura. And this will be a building very similar to what we have at Lennar, the same sort of specialties as well, although that hasn't been exactly decided. So all these extra buildings plus more are taking place because of the secure financial situation that the enterprise is currently in. Never before in the history of UHealth or the University of Miami has such an extensive building proposition been taking place. And the Department of Medicine is very much part and parcel of it. Here's a site plan for the Solomia practice. And second to last, this is an example of the Miller Medical Education Building that's ground was broken a couple of weeks ago. This is right outside the Converge building. This is 110,000 square foot building with ample conference room space. This is where the university, the Miller School of Medicine education will go. And we've already occupied several floors in Converge with University of Miami researchers and scientists. This will extend our medical campus to the highway, if you will, and there will be a series of projects in order to allow for easy transport between the hospital as it exists now and this medical education building. And the last building is the new cancer research building, which recently received U Health Board approval on Friday, which is a $248 million building due to the work of Dr. Nimer, the Dean, President Frank, and many others that will be going up on around 10th Avenue in that area. So a multi-story new research building, over $1.3 billion worth of investment. So where does that bring our research mission? What are we doing in terms of research? If we're building this new research building, how are we growing? How are we doing? So if we look at the Blue Ridge Institute for Medical Research, which just looks at federal grants awarded, this is the School of Medicine rank, which is separated from the Department of Medicine ranks. And this is the rankings from 2018, 19, and 20. 2021 isn't yet compiled. So the School of Medicine says stuck pretty much around between 40, 39, and 40. The Department of Medicine, due to the efforts of those of you on this call, went from 55 to 52 to 51. And it's my hope that with the recruitment of these, of many high-powered investigators, some of whom I showed on the previous slide about new recruits, will bring us clearly to number 50. If we look at the number of dollars you need in order to be in the top 10 and see where we are now, this is, or where we were in 2020, you can see there's hundreds of thousands of dollars in grants that go to these departments of medicine. Whereas in the University of Miami Department of Medicine is a lot lower. Now, if you do this per capita, it probably is much more equal. Here are total research expenditures, grants and contracts in direct costs in red, indirect costs in blue, and the total is in orange. We pretty much stayed the same during the COVID. It went down a little bit during COVID, despite the fact that we got lots of COVID awards that we didn't necessarily increase and couldn't renew many of our other awards because our labs were closed in many instances. This is research expenditures as opposed to the number that I gave you earlier, which was more related to research dollars awarded. Here are some of the notice of awards that we got in FY21. And we're expecting more in FY22. I'd like to call out the T35 that Dr. Fornoni got, which is not an insignificant award. It is really due to help us train individuals and get them interested in our subspecialties, the F awards as well. And then we had at least five R01s, a K23, and additional Ks as well. So this is just an example of the growth that we've seen this year, despite the presence of COVID and the pandemic. What about our education mission? Where have we been this year? So we have an amazing internal medicine residency program, and these are the residency program. This is not even all the fellowship directors and all the subspecialties. Dr. Brown is our chief, and we really have to thank our associate program directors who have been essential in maintaining not only the workings of our residency program, but the mental health of our residents. It's been very stressful for them, as you can well imagine, coming during a pandemic and starting your internship without being able to go and socialize with people, without being able to develop that camaraderie. I mean, many of us, when we think back on our residencies, it was really our fellow residents that became our family. And if you can imagine having to be estranged from your family as you're just starting out on residency, can be doubly stressful. But with the help of these program directors and Dr. Allspach, many people have been involved in making sure of the well-being of our residents. We also have leaders among our residents in PGY 4 years as chief residents. Here's a nod to those individuals that were our chief residents in 2021 on the left in the composite picture, and then the individual pictures of our chief residents, two of whom are at Jackson Inpatient, one at Jackson Ambulatory Center, two at the VA, one at University of Miami Hospital, and several quality VA chief residents. As far as the match, we had 39 categorical interns. Four of them were UM students, one AOA, eight Gold Humanism Honor Society students, and 47% of our residents are underrepresented minorities. We also had seven Bascom-Palmer integrated ophthalmology residents and four preliminary interns. This is just our residency match, not our fellow match, but we also have a very robust, one of the largest programs in the country for combined medicine pediatrics residencies. And these programs are led by Jonathan Tolentino and Kendra Van Kirk as program director and associate program director, respectively. They have 50% underrepresented minorities, 66% female, four Gold Humanism Honor Society. So we continue to do very well in the match. And this is a real fine art of balancing, because during the pandemic, as you know, we didn't have the ability to have in-person interviews. So these were all done by Zoom. That was both a blessing and a curse. It was a blessing because people didn't have to spend money in order to come and see what the University of Miami is like. So people that might not have otherwise looked at us that couldn't afford to were able to do so. On the other hand, there were many just people that were curious and looked and weren't really serious necessarily about coming. But in the end, we got in a stellar group of residents and fellows, I should add, to come to all our programs. And then finances. What do the finances look like for UHealth in general, and then for the Department of Medicine? So forgive me for this. Forgive me for this somewhat busy slide. I would just call your attention to the very bottom line. If you could mute yourself if you're not speaking. Thank you. Okay, we got him. if you look at the very bottom line, which is the operating margin, this is the current year to date, which is essentially ended in FY21 in May. And these are in millions of dollars. And this is the prior year to date. So in FY20, we ended up losing $30.2 million in the red. We had $2.8 billion in revenues and $2.85 billion in expenses. And we ended up losing $30.2 million. However, in the current year, because of the hard work that everyone did in keeping the hospitals well, increasing our productivity, increasing the number of procedures, and the grants that we've gotten, we actually ended up FY21 with a $301.6 million surplus. This was $240 million better than what our financial planning had shown. And so it is this money that gives us the right, so to speak, to build these buildings and to alter our compensation plan, which you will be hearing about in the very near future, to have a more equitable and a more palatable compensation plan for all our faculty. Right now, it's nothing I can give you details on because it still needs to be finally reviewed by the leadership and then ultimately by the Board of Trustees to have approval. But you'll be hearing more about that in the coming months. And lastly, just to give you a perspective of what the Department of Medicine contributes to the overall financial health of the institution. If you look at work RVUs in the first part, and charges on the far right between FY20 and FY21, you'll see that the Department of Medicine is responsible for FY21 for 19% of all the work RVUs generated throughout UHealth. That's pretty significant that one department is responsible for 20%. Now, pathology was 21%, but if you look at the actual number of dollars charged, we account for 16% of all the charges that are generated by UHealth, including the hospital, including everything, pro fees. These are not downstream facility fees, and that pathology was 9%. So you can see who the big cheeses are, and you are the big cheese because you are responsible for a great deal of the UHealth's financial success and the financial health of UHealth. In addition to that, we've had over $5.5 million this year alone in philanthropy. I illustrate here some of the larger gifts, and there is also just recently a $1 million gift from an anonymous donor to our Crohn's and Colitis Center that's not even on here because it came in after the FY21 year. But there's $1.1 million in a functional lung imaging research program, $500,000 in an asthma research fund, $450,000 for Crohn's and colitis, $250,000 in general medicine, $100,000 for UHealth for COVID-19, arrhythmia research, $125,000, heart rhythm, $125,000, and $170,000 for idea exchange. This is major. I mean, we can't count on philanthropy to float the boat, but when it does occur and you have grateful patients that can help, it's what that enables you to do what you want to do in terms of your scholarship and creativity. So it's very important to remember the role of philanthropy. And not least of all is the concern that we have about faculty wellness. I talked a little bit about our residents and how concerned we are about their wellness and what we're doing. But I wanted to announce to you a program that is being initiated in the coming weeks between the Department of Medicine and the Department of Psychiatry and Behavioral Sciences. We are going to have Dr. Radu from the Department of Psychiatry hold individual division sessions to actually discuss burnout and to discuss what it is that we can do in order to help our faculty deal with the stresses of the pandemic and the stresses of academic life. So look forward to more of that. Unfortunately, it's been a sad year too of some of our losses that we had. Dr. Bisno, many of you may remember, was a retired professor here in the Department of Medicine, and he was vice chair of medicine for some time and chief of medicine at the VA Medical Center. He was an infectious disease specialist and was beloved by all of those who knew him. We also lost at an early age Dr. Manton. Dr. Howard Manton was a gastroenterologist, and he was a retired associate professor in the Division of Digestive Health. And he really was a dedicated educator. His legacy lives on in his son, Emery, who's an active faculty member in our Division of Digestive Health, who is equally, although he won't see this as good as his father, but his father will be sorely missed as an educator for our house staff and our fellows, and truly a doctor's doctor in that regard. And thirdly, we lost Dr. Lawrence Fishman this year. Dr. Fishman was an emeritus professor and former chief of the Division of Endocrinology and Metabolism at the VA. Now, one thing all these three people have in common, and I don't want to belabor this point, they all were at the VA, but I don't think that has anything to do with how this slide turned out. But it goes to show you there was a time when the VA was an integral part of the Department of Medicine. And we're working very hard with the Dean and Joan St. Ange and Maria Abreu and Naresh Punjabi to rebuild what once was an amazing collaboration. And in the legacy of these three giants, we hope that we will be successful in that regard. We miss them all very much. And now we turn to the State of the Department address, the awards. This year, I want to announce that starting next year, we will have awards not just for faculty, but awards for staff. And you'll be hearing very soon about nominations and the processes that we will have for our staff that are also deserving of accolades and awards. I'd like to have the first award to be given by Dr. Maria Abreu, our Vice Chair of Research, and she will present the Shally Research Award. Dr. Abreu, can you unmute yourself?
Yeah. Hey, boss. I'm unmuted. Okay. I don't know if all of you know Dr. Shally, who was also at the VA, mostly at the VA, a Nobel Prize winner, the only Nobel Prize winner among us, and who discovered various pituitary hormones and was awarded the Nobel Prize. I don't remember if it was in the 70s that he was awarded this. But in his honor, I'm very pleased to announce two wonderful friends and colleagues that are now going to win the 2021 Research Awards. I'll begin with Suzanne Dobleki-Lewis. We already heard from Dr. Weiss. Her contributions actually that help all of us. She really was, although her passion has always been HIV and prevention of HIV, and has been part of a network to try to make discoveries in that space, she was quickly able to turn that around and put us in a very positive light here at the University of Miami, leading these efforts having to do with vaccination for COVID-19, and really has been a model citizen for us. And I see that from a variety of perspectives. So we're very pleased to give Suzanne that award. And then to my colleague in GI, Dr. David Goldberg. Every time we turn around, we get an email that he got another NIH grant or is leading a UO1 grant here. David's interest, of course, is in transplantation and equitable distribution of organs, and is now leading a UO1 effort on liver cirrhosis and part of the Liver Cirrhosis Network. So two very deserving clinician scientists, and congratulations.
Thank you. Thank you, Maria. And thank you, Dr. Dobleki-Lewis and Dr. Goldberg, for being inspirational to all of us in the amazing research that you do that really illustrates the importance of who we are as the Department of Medicine. Thank you. Next, I'd like to call Dr. Michael Kolber, our Vice Chair for Clinical Affairs, sometimes also Interim Chief of Hospital Medicine, and always a good friend of everybody in the Department of Medicine. Dr. Kolber, will you please present the Distinguished Clinician Award?
Yes, thank you, Dr. Weiss. It's truly a pleasure to present this award to a very deserving clinician. I have to say that when you get this award, it's probably one of the highest awards you can get because you are being voted on by your peers. So you are a clinician's clinician. And I can't think of a person who's more deserving than Dr. Eli O'Donna, who has been with us for many years and has been not only a role model, an educator, but what are leading people in outpatient pulmonary medicine. And I thank him for all he does.
Thank you, Dr. Kolber. Thank you, Dr. Donna, for being really the clinician we all go to whenever we cough, and and many other things as well. Your wisdom and your ability to care for patients in such large numbers as well, and do it so well with such high quality, is truly inspiring. I don't know if you're on the call, you're probably busy in clinic seeing patients, but we're recording this so you can get a copy to show your family. Next, Dr. Deshpande, Dr. Lowry. If you could present our diversity award. Dr. Lowry is Vice Chair for Appointments, Promotion, and Diversity and Inclusion in the department.
Hi, everyone. It is truly an honor to present this award, a very distinguished award, for his efforts in diversity. And this year's recipient is Dr. Olveen Carrasquillo. He was preceded by Dr. Tooks and Dr. Brown, as you previously saw. He's been a leader in the department as chief of the Division of General Medicine, as well as diversity. So please join me in congratulating Dr. Olveen Carrasquillo for his work in diversity. And we certainly support further growth in that area. Dr. Carrasquillo.
Thank you, Olveen, and thank you, Mo. This was great. And just remember that, you know, everyone here is a winner. The fact that when you have a group of colleagues that are like family to you, it's like when your own child wins an award, you get the pleasure from it as well. And so all of you should get pleasure from the honor that's given to your colleagues here, because truly each and every one of you is deserving an award. I give you an award, but we only give one picture. So that's it for today. And now Dr. Deshpande, I believe you're going to present the Distinguished Educator Award as Vice Chair of Education in the Department of Medicine.
So thank you, Dr. Weiss. And so we're really pleased to, I don't know how that 2019 guy on the right got on there, but we're pleased to present the 2021 Distinguished Educator Awards. You see ones that have won it in years past. Dan Sussman from the Division of Digestive Health and Liver Disease, who has run our pre-clerkship course in GI and liver disease, and also has been an instrumental member of the fellowship program over many years in GI. And Erin Marcus, who has a very important roles both in the UME world, where she's a longitudinal clinical educator for our medical students, as well as an associate program director of the internal medicine residency. So we thank both of them. And also, in addition to all of the great GME stuff Dr. Weiss mentioned, the internal medicine clerkship also won the best clerkship award and our pre-clerkship modules as well. So very proud of our department educators, and thanks for all that you guys do.
Thank you, Dr. Deshpande. And Dan and Erin, thank you so much, because the reason we're here is to teach. And not everyone gets the opportunity to do it. And if more of you want it, we definitely will allow you to do so. But you really exemplify what we wake up in the morning wanting to do, is to teach, and the excitement of teaching and seeing that sparkle in the eye when you explain, oh, you mean it's not renal, it's not heart failure, it's actually a pneumonia, or it's colitis, that's what it is, Dr. Sussman. Anyway, all good. Thank you very much for being the distinguished educators. And now we come to the final award for the season. And this actually is a named award. And if you have a special key, you can get into the corridor on the third floor now. They locked me in here. I guess too many people threatened by life. That if you can get in, you'll see a plaque on the wall where we have a list of the Barkin Rogers Outstanding Mentor Award. Now, this is made by Jamie Barkin and Dr. Rogers, both of whom were in the Division of Digestive Health, and Dr. Barkin still is. Dr. Rogers has since retired. And they wanted to give an award for someone who is truly represents an outstanding mentor. And and we've been doing this, all these awards we've been doing since I came in 2016, something like that. Anyway, so Dr. Gardner won it in 2019, Dr. Fornoni in 2020. And it is my great pleasure and privilege to announce Dr. Maria Abreu is going, act surprised, Maria, let me see, take off the mask. Okay, is our truly outstanding mentor award. Maria neither sleeps nor slumbers. Every day she's out looking to help the mission of her trainees, and not just her trainees, she's looking out for the benefit of everybody in the Department of Medicine, how we can make it better, how we can support them, what it means to be a mentor. We talk about mentorship in terms of our science, but it's also important to understand that our mentees look to us not just because of what we do scientifically or our prowess as a clinician, but it's what we do as a human being. Are we ethical human beings? Do we look out for each other? Do we really fulfill the mission that we're supposed to fulfill on this earth as human beings. And so a lofty mission, no question, but that's what a good mentor does. And Maria, we're glad you're the mentor for 2021. So with that, my friends, concludes our State of the Department address. I apologize if I missed somebody or misstated something. I only meant the best. I am telling you what a distinct privilege and honor it is to be the chairman of this department. It rides on your coattails, and I'm just happy to be part of it. I wish you all good health in the coming year as we begin our academic year. I wish you success in everything that you do, and we look forward to an invigorated and even more productive year in 2022. Thank you all for coming today. And although we don't have salty donuts, as we usually do, next year we'll have a double portion. So thank you, everyone, and have a nice afternoon. All right, everybody go to clinic.